Good morning, Vandan. Today we are going to continue our discussion with CART, classification and regression tree. In CART approach, six general kinds of questions arise. First question, should the properties be restricted to binary valued or allowed to be multi-valued? That is, how many decision outcomes or splits will be there at a node? For example, if you look into this one, at this particular node, outlook node, we have three possible outcomes, right? And for this particular node, humidity, two possible outcomes. For this node, we have two possible outcomes. H3, 2 and 2. That's what we are trying to discuss here. How many possible splits or how many possible outcomes we can expect from a node? And what can be the ideal one? Which property should be tested at a node? Which property should be tested at a node means, for example, we may have decision tree with root node as outlook and second one as humidity, or we may have root node as humidity and the second node as outlook. We may have root node as wind and second node as humidity or outlook, whatever, like that. That priority we need to decide which property should be tested at a node. When should a node be declared as a leaf? Because if you try to have pure classifiers at the end, pure category at the end, only single class labels at the end of the leaf, there is a chance for overfitting. Sometimes you may not require to do up to that level, complete pureness, because noise might be there in our labels. In such scenario, that may lead to overfitting, that is like by heart along with noise. If the tree becomes too large, how can it be made smaller and simpler? That is, it's called as pruning. How to prune the tree? Because large tree may lead to overfitting, that we can see later. If a leaf node is impure, how should the category label be assigned? Impure leaf node means, for example, let's have in our leaf node total 10 samples are there. Suppose first 8 samples corresponds to class 1, second 2 samples corresponds to class 2. This is impure, right? We can't simply say that leaf node output is either class 1 or class 2 straight away, right? How to decide based on this? Shall we go based on majority? Here 8 labels corresponds to class 1, 2 labels corresponds to class 2. That means with probability 0.8, that is class 1, with probability 0.2, that is class 2. Shall you do like that? That's what we need to see. Or shall you go for majority? And how should the missing data to be handled in decision trees? Here are the 6 questions we are going to see. First one, number of splits. Because the universal expressive power of binary trees and the comparative simplicity in training, we shall concentrate on binary trees. Binary trees means each node will try to give two possible outcomes. One is yes, second one is no. Yes or no kind of output. Only two possibilities, right? Binary. Only two possibilities. You can see. Here we are trying to ask. This is once again when you look into that fruit classification example. Fruits classification example. First question we are going to ask is the color green? Is the color green? Instead of asking what is the color, if you ask what is the color, we have three possible splits earlier, right? Let's say I look into that splitting. You can see, if I ask what is the color, three possibilities are there, three outcomes, either green or yellow or red. But in this case, instead of having three branches, we want to have only two branches. We want to have binary tree. That's why we are straight away asking the question like, is the color green? Yes or no? If yes, then go for size. Is the size big? If big, go for yes or no. Earlier we saw like size means big, small or medium kind of thing, right? Outcomes. Here we are straight away asking, is the size big? Is the size medium? Is the size small? Like that. Such questions we are asking. We want yes or no kind of thing. we can try to have a look into this one. Try to compare with that last tree, earlier tree that we had discussed in previous session. It means that it is possible to represent a decision tree or a chord in binary form always. It's possible. It's possible to represent the chord in the form of a binary decision tree. That's always possible. You can have such questions at the node. You can see either color green, either color yellow, or either shape round like that. Such kind of questions you can raise at the each and every node. In that way, you can have binary decision trees. Test selection and node impurity. Much of the work in designing trees focuses on deciding which property test or query should be performed at each node. With non-numeric data, there is no geometrical interpretation of how the test at the node spits the data. However, for numerical data, there is a simple way to visualize the decision boundaries that are produced by decision trees. Non-numeric data means, for example, what is the color? Green, yellow, or red kind of thing. That's non-numeric data, right? That's not having numbers or numerical output. That's not having numerical value, right? That particular attribute don't have numerical values. If you look into numerical values, we can have such kind of questions. You can look into this. Suppose this particular feature or attribute or that node xi can take real values. Then we can have such kind of questions. Is xi less than or equal to some theta? Here in place of theta we are having xis. Some threshold you can give. Is xi less than or equal to that threshold or not? Yes or no question. Binary kind of thing. This is the image. Hyperplane decision boundary. And for example, you can have a look into this one. In this case, this is class A, this is class B, this is class C, this is class D, class E. And we are having two features. X1 is one feature, X2 is another feature. Each one can take real values. X1 can take real values or X2 can also take real values. Now we will try to form a decision tree as follows. This is a root node. At root node, we are asking a question, is x1 greater than theta 1? If x1 greater than theta 1, go this way. If x1 less than theta 1, go this way. Like that you can follow. Otherwise, you can go in this way. Yeah, that's the way we are going to follow. Yeah, this is yes, this is no, right? Let's follow standard notation only. Yes, left side, right side, no, right? Is x1 greater than theta 1? If yes, go this way. If no, go this way. Here, at this node, we are asking, is x2 less than or equal to theta 2? If less than or equal to theta 2, go this way. Otherwise, go this way. Such kind of questions we are asking. For example, let's have a look into this one. In this case, for class A, x1 is less than theta 1, less than or equal to theta 1, and x2 is less than or equal to theta 2. You can have a look into this. x2 less than or equal to theta 2, x1 less than or equal to theta 1. Let's try to see what's happening here in order to approach to class A. If x1 less than, if x1 greater than theta 1, if x1 greater than theta 1, go this way. Yeah, sorry, there's a mistake in the last sentence. This branch corresponds to x1 greater than theta 1. This branch corresponds to x1 less than or equal to theta 1. If x1 less than or equal to theta 1, go this way. And this branch corresponds to x2 less than or equal to theta 2. If x2 less than or equal to theta 2, go this way. Then this is called as node A. And let's have a look into node B. x1 less than or equal to theta 1 followed by x2 greater than theta 2. x1 less than or equal to theta 1 for B followed by x2 greater than or equal to theta 2. You can see this, right? This is x2 less than or equal to theta 2. Then this should be x2 greater than theta 2, right? Is x2 less than or equal to theta 2? If yes, this is, if no, this one. Like that. You can try to have a comparison with this and this. The fundamental principle underlying tree creation is that simplicity. We prefer decisions that lead to a simple, compact decision tree with few nodes. That's what our target. We want a small decision tree. We don't want that lengthy decision tree. That's a general expectation. This is a version of Occam's razor. That is the simplest model that explains data is the one to be preferred. This is Occam's razor. One should not use classifiers that are more complicated than or necessary, where necessary is determined by the quality of fit to the training data. Suppose if I want a training error, if I can tolerate it, any training error of 0.01 training error, I can tolerate. Suppose with the training error criteria, I satisfied with two decision trees. One decision tree is simple, that means very less number of nodes are there in that one, and another decision node is complex, or that is lengthy. I have so many nodes in the decision tree. Then I will try to prefer that first one, whichever is simple, that I will try to prefer, because second one might lead to overfitting in general. This is the concept of Occam's razor. If I satisfy that same probability of error criteria for both of them, then I'll try to go with simpler one. I don't want to go for complex one. I don't want to go for so many number of nodes in my decision tree. That's the plan behind this Occam's razor. I'll try to pick simpler one. Node impurity. Let I of n denote the impurity of a node n. In all cases, we want I of n, it means node impurity, to be 0. If all the patterns that reach the node 2 bear the same category label, and to be larger if the categories are equally represented.
For example, let's assume that I am a particular node, some node n.
And let's assume that I have two possible classes means some omega 1, omega 2. Let's assume that I have 10 training samples at that particular node. Now, for example, 10 out of 10 samples corresponds to class 1. There is no class 2 sample at that node. Then that is pure node. That is called as pure node. Suppose I have 0 for class 1, I have 10 samples for class 2, then that's also called as pure node. With certainty, I can say whether class 1 or class 2. Suppose 10 samples are from class 1, 0 from class 2. With probability 1, I can say that if I somehow reach to that node, I can say that that is class 1. Suppose at that particular node, I have class 1 samples 5, class 2 samples 5 at that particular node. And when I reach to that node, can I say that my test sample belongs to class 1 or my test sample belongs to class 2? Can I say like that? It's not easy, right? Because both are equally likely. 5 out of 10 samples corresponds to class 1 in the training. In the training time, 5 out of 10 samples corresponds to class 2. It means with probability 1 by 2, that might be class 1. With probability 1 by 2, that might be class 2, right? This is highly uncertain. If I reach to that node, that particular node, during test time, I can't say whether it belongs to class 1 or class 2. This is highly uncertain, right? Both are equally probable. That's what we are going to say here in this. The most popular measure is the entropy impurity, or occasionally this is also called as information impurity. You might have seen this in your digital communications course, right? I of n equal to sigma j p of omega j log 2 p of omega j. Let's assume that we are having C classes with as j equal to 1 to C. J equal to 1 to C, where P of J is the fraction of patterns at node N that are in category omega J. Let's try to have an example for this. What I am going to say here is, for example, somehow I reach to a particular node during this decision tree somewhere. Let's assume that I am at this point, for example, I am at this node n. let's assume this node N. At this node, I have total, let's say, three classes, omega 1, omega 2, omega 3, total three possible classes. At this node, I have roughly 10 training examples at this node. 10 training examples reached to this particular node. For example, 10 training examples reached to this particular node after splitting. Suppose. And let's say 2 are belongs to class 1 and 3 are belongs to class 2 and 5 are belongs to total 10. Total 10 reached to this node. 10 training examples reached to this particular node. Out of those 10, 2 belongs to class 1, 3 belongs to class 2 and 5 belongs to class 3. Now, P of omega 1 will be 2 by 10, fraction of samples per class 1 at this node, right? 2 divided by total, totally 10, this is 0.2. And probability of omega 2 or P of omega 2 equals to 3 by 10, fraction of samples, right? And P of omega 3 equals to, you see, 5 by 10. In that way, I can have this. And from this, I will try to find the entropy. I will try to substitute them into this entropy formula. If I got high entropy means high uncertainty. If I got zero entropy means that is a pure class. Zero entropy you can get only when one of those three probabilities is 1, others are zeros. Suppose P of omega 1 equal to 1 and remain 2 are 0, then my entropy is 0. Same thing for other two classes also. That is pure class, right? That is called as pure if entropy is 0. In general, you may get non-zero entropy. Some positive quantity you are going to get. Highest entropy or highest uncertainty we can get when all of them are equally probable. For example, I have 9 samples reached to that particular node instead of 10. 9 samples reached to particular node, that particular node N. And out of those 9 samples, 3 belongs to class 1, 3 belongs to class 2, 3 belongs to class 3. Then probability of omega 1 is 1 by 3, probability of omega 2 equals 1 by 3, probability of omega 3 equals 1 by 3. In that case, I am going to get the highest entropy, which is same as log 3 base 2. This is the highest uncertainty I am going to get. That's highly impure, that node. Like that you can think. That's extreme case. By the well-known properties of entropy, if all the patterns are of the same category, the impurity is zero. Otherwise, it is positive, with the greatest value occurring when the different classes are equally likely, as we discussed just now. Some of the other node impurity measures. Variance impurity measure, Gini impurity measure, misclassification impurity measure. You can have a look into this. Test selection. We now come to the key question. Given a partial tree down to node N, what value S should we choose for that property test T? An obvious heuristic is to choose the test that decreases the impurity as much as we can. The drop in impurity is defined as follows. Delta I of n equals to I of n minus PL into I of NL plus 1 minus PL into I of NR. Here L corresponds to left, R corresponds to right of that particular node. We have two branches, right? This is a binary decision tree. In a binary decision tree, we have two branches. First branch is left one, second branch is right one, like that you can think. Where NL and NR are the left and right descendant nodes, I of NL and I of NR are their impurities, and PL is the fraction of patterns at node N that will go to NL when property test T is used. Then the best test value S is the choice for T that maximizes delta I of T. We want to maximize delta I of T. Because delta I of T corresponds to drop in impurity. You want to reduce that impurity level, right? You want to make the outcome are that leaf nodes, whatever the subsequent nodes we are going to get, that should be less impure. Our target should be, we should try to decrease that impurity as much as we can. That's what our target. We want to form a pure classes at the end. That's our goal, right? If the entropy impurity is used, then the impurity reduction corresponds to an information gain provided by the query. For example, consider this case. We have two types of fishes, type A fishes and type B fishes. Based on length and weight, we are trying to classify them. These are the features. Length is one feature and weight is second feature. This is a type A fishes. Total number of type A fishes in this set are, how many type A fishes are there? 9000 plus 1000. 10,000 type A fishes, and we have 10,000 type B fishes. Out of 10,000 type A fishes, these are two variants. We can try to have a look into these two rows. Let us assume equal effort for measuring length and weight. Then which feature will be good for root node? Let's try both of them and try to see what's happening here. Let's consider my root node to be weight instead of length. I started with weight as my root node. Suppose if my weight is less than 3 kgs, then what I am going to have is, weight is less than 3 kgs means, weight less than 3 kgs. What is the meaning of that? If that is true, what's going to happen? Less than 3 weight means only this second row possibility is there, right? Less than 3 weight means only this second row. None of them belongs to less than 3. Only this part belongs to less than 3 weight. You see 3 to 6, 0.5 to 3, 3 to 6 weight. Only type A fishes we are having less than 3 kgs. 1000 such type A fishes are there total. 1000 type A fishes. If this is false, it means weight is greater than or equal to 3. If weight greater than or equal to 3, what are the possibilities? You can see 3 to 6, type A fishes 9000, and above 3, type B fishes 10,000. This is a combination of both, right? This is impure. Earlier, this is a pure. Pure means we have all samples belongs to class A or type A here. Type A here, all samples. But at this node, we have combination of both, right? 9000 type A fishes plus 10,000 type B fishes. Now we need to go for one more feature or one more attribute. Let's try with length. We left with this one and this one, right? 9000 and 10,000. Where length of this is 3 to 5, length of this is 1 to 3. Now I can have a question like, if the length is less than 3 feet, then that is type B. If length is above 3 feet, that is type A, right? Whether length is less than 3, yes. If that is yes, that is type B fishes. All 10,000 samples are type B fishes here. And if length is above 3, then all of them are type A fishes. 9,000 type A fishes we are getting. You can see, we can call them like leaf nodes, right? All of them are pure. This is pure, this is pure, this is also pure. Type A, type B, type A. All of them are pure nodes. There is no impurity, there is no combination of A and B. For example, yeah, this is with the help of training data I had and all these things. Suppose someone gave me a test sample or test some fish for testing purpose. I want to classify into type A or type B. Let's assume that length of that fish is 3.5 feet, and weight of that fish is 4 kgs. Then what will be the class? Weight is 4 kgs. Weight less than 3 means this is not less than 3. No, that will go here. And length, is it less than 3? Length is 3.5, right? Length 3.5 means we will go this way. Then that will come under type A. Let's try to compare here. And then type A fish, right? Length 3.5 and weight corresponds to 4 kgs. This type A fish. In that way, you can classify. And let's consider length as a root node instead of weight. My first question I am going to ask is, this is a binary decision tree. Is the length less than 3 feet? If the length less than 3 feet, there are two possibilities. You can see these two rows correspond to that, right? One possibility is there are 1000 type A fishes and 10,000 type B fishes in that one, less than 3. If length is more than 3, I have only one possibility. Type A fish, 9,000 type A fishes. This is pure, right? I am going to get pure 9,000 type A fishes. No need to continue further, right? Because it's a pure class. No need to have one more node here. This is a leaf node. If length is less than 3, I have 1000 type A plus 10,000 type B. Now I will focus on weight. If weight less than 3, then that is type A. If weight greater than or equal to 3, then that is type B. You can try to do that, right? Is weight less than 3? If that is true, that is type A. All 1000 fishes are type A. If no, the remaining 10,000 fishes corresponds to type B. Now try to see which one may require more effort for you or more number of measurements. Our assumption is we will have equal effort to measure length of the fish or to measure weight of the fish. Then how many measurements we have considered total? We want to reduce the total number of measurements required. That's what our plan here. Total number of measurements should be less. So that requires some time or some effort, right, for each measurement. I want to reduce the number of measurements as much as I can. Here try to see how many measurements that we had done in total here. If you look into this length, we had a length measurement for how many fishes? 10,000 plus 9,000, 19,000, right? For 19,000 fishes, we had taken length measurement, 19,000 plus how many weight measurements we had done? We had done weight measurement for all fishes, right? For all of them, all 20,000. 20,000 plus 19,000, total 39,000 measurements we had done, 39,000. In this case, how many measurements we had done? Regarding weight, we had done 10,000 plus 1,000, 11,000 measurements. Regarding length, we had done for all, right, 20,000. 20 plus 11, 31,000 measurements for this, 39,000 measurements for this. Now it looks good as compared to first one, right? Considering length as a root node looks very good compared to that first one. Let's try to analyze this one with the help of our information gain or entropy measurements. How to analyze this? Let's have an analysis for that. Suppose I want to select a root node. Which root node is good for me? I want to test. These are the possibilities. Case 1. Possible root nodes. Case 1 corresponds to is weight less than 3 kgs. This is one of the possible root node. Another possible root node is length less than 3 feet. The second possible root node that we have considered, right, is length less than 3 feet. Which one might be better? According to our theory, we need to find the node which will try to reduce that impurity level, right?
we want to maximize this one. We want to maximize this term. That's what our target. Where this corresponds to entropy. Let's have a look into this first. Let's consider weight as a measure. If you go with weight as a measure, what is the impurity level at root node? By default, impurity at root node is common for both the cases, right? Because there is no splitting we had done till we started splitting only at root node. We have only two possible classes, P of A and P of B. Type A and type B fish, like that, class A, class B, or type A, type B. What is the fraction of fishes at root node corresponds to type A? There are 20,000 fishes. Out of 20,000, 10,000 corresponds to type A. 10,000 by 20,000, 1 by 2 fraction, right? Here also 10,000 by 20,000. This fraction also 1 by 2. Then I of root node will be, I of root node corresponds to, let's try to substitute into that expression, minus 1 by 2, this is entropy expression, right? Minus 1 by 2 log base 2 into 1 by 2. Once again, minus 1 by 2, this is P of A minus P of A log base 2 P of A minus P of B log base 2 P of B. 1 by 2. Then this is going to be equals to 1. This is the amount of uncertainty I am having without splitting. Suppose if I go for case 1, where my case 1 corresponds to weight. If weight less than 3 kgs, then what I am going to get? If weight less than 3 kgs, if this is true, I am getting a pure node. Pure node at this case, right? And I am going to get impure node at this case, at this side, impure node. 10,000 type B plus 9,000 type A here. This is right side. Left side, I have 1,000, right? Let's try to map to that notation. I want to follow that notation only. It's a formula we are going to have, right? I of n minus I of n, here n equal to root, minus PL into I of NL plus 1 minus PL into I of NR. Let's try to calculate what is I of NL and PL. What is I of NL here? In this case, I of N or I of root is 1 and I of NL equals to 0. Why that is 0? I of NL equal to 0. Why? Because this left side, this is left, this is right. This is NL node, this is NR. At NR, we are having 10,000 type B, 9,000 type B. At NL, we have all type A fishes. It means P of A equal to 1, fraction of fishes. 2 type A are 1, P of A equal to 1, P of B equal to 0 here. We substitute P of A equal to 1 and P of B equal to 0 in that entropy formula. That is minus P of A log P of A base 2 minus P of B log P of B base 2. Then I am going to get 0, right? 0 log 0 is 0. You can consider like that. And log 1 base 2 is 0, right? This I of NL is 0. Entropy for this one is 0. And what is PL? PL means fraction of samples that came till this point, right? How many fraction? 1000 divided by total number of samples we are having here are 20,000. 1000 by 20,000 means 1 by 20. 1 by 20, right? You see 1 by 20. Then what will be my I of NR corresponds to, yeah, what is my I of NR? I want to find impurity of this node. I have total 10,000 type B and 9,000 type A. It means my P of A will be 9 by 19, total, right? 9000 divided by 19000, 9 by 19. And my P of B at this node will be, P of B will be 10 by 19, 9 by 19 and 10 by 19. I can try to do this, right? 9 by 19 minus log 9 by 19 base 2 minus 10 by 19 log 2 10 by 19 base 2. Oh, this is base 2, right? This is I of nr. Then what will be my fraction? That pr, right side. 1000 left side I am having total after splitting. I have 19,000 samples this side, right? 19,000 divided by total 20,000. 19,000 plus 1000. 19 by 20, PR. I can simply substitute all the things into this expression. I have n minus this whole thing. Then I will get some drop in impurity, delta I of n, or that's called as information gain. This is also called as information gain. If I go for root node as weight, if I go with weight as my root node, that's the amount of information gain I am going to get. Similarly, try to calculate the amount of information gain I am going to get with the help of length as a root node. Then try to compare both of them. Whichever is having highest value, highest information gain, that I will try to consider as my best possible root node. That's what my plan. And you can repeat the same thing throughout. Note that the optimization maximizing delta I of n is local, done at a single node. Similar to such greedy methods, there is no guarantee that successive locally optimal decisions leads to global optimum. Thank you.